RadioOrNot.com and SoFloRadio.com present The Nicole Sandler Show.
Truth to power, baby.
And now, here's Nicole.
Boy, yes we do. Do you ever feel like it's, you know, two steps up, one step back? Sometimes it's one step up, two steps back. Yeah, right? Nicole Sandler here. Welcome to a Tuesday. Coming to you live at RadioOrNot.com. Of course, all of our various streams to watch or listen to the show are accessible right there, RadioOrNot.com. We broadcast audio via SoFloRadio.com and TalkRadio1.com. And, of course, video via Ustream and YouTube. And, again, you can get all the links right there on the homepage at RadioOrNot.com. If you tuned in for the pre-show music, I do that so that if you tune in earlier, especially on the Ustream, you can get up, you get through the commercial they play at the beginning. Some people have asked why I don't put the pre-show music on YouTube, because the thing is, once I start the YouTube stream, it automatically records everything, and I can't record and then put the songs in the podcast. So, yeah, that's what that's about. But the pre-show music goes out over over Talk Radio 1 and our Ustream feed. If you're listening on SoFlow Radio, they have a show on before mine, so we kick in there right at 10. And on YouTube, the live stream on YouTube, I start again right as the show begins. So that's the mechanics behind all of that. So if you did find us early in the show, if you did listen to the pre-show music today, you heard some songs about pride, you know, sort of taking a little bit of poetic license there. But it was, you know, it's been a weird couple of days. And let me explain why. And you may not even know who Michelle Schacht is. But I've been a fan of Michelle Schacht's and a friend of sorts for, I don't know, 20, 25 years. Regular listeners of the show know that I started in music radio. Well, I actually started in talk radio, but the bulk of my career was in music radio. And I was in Los Angeles the late 80s working at a station called KNX FM, which was sort of, you know, adult rock. Yeah, the precursor to the AAA format, which, again, unless you live in Chicago or Austin, Texas or Philadelphia, a handful of other cities you might not be familiar with, but it's adult album alternative. It's a bad name for, you know, really good music radio, and I know there isn't much of that anymore. AAA radio plays a lot of artists that don't get heard elsewhere, and more that you do hear in other places, but you, that were broken through this format. Dave Matthews and Sheryl Crow and Nora Jones and the list goes on and on of artists, even Gautier, you know, artists that got started on AAA that then broke through big. Mumford and Sons, you know, AAA radio is playing Mumford and Sons for a couple of years now. And all of a sudden now they're a new band, right? So anyway, I was working at the station in Los Angeles, KNX FM, back in the late 80s. And Bruce Hornsby, yeah, right? But Bruce Hornsby was pre-AAA, actually, Mike M. So late 80s, Michelle Schacht's first album came out called Short Sharp Schacht. And she was then on Mercury Records, and the first single that they were working was a song called If Love Was a Train, or If Love Were a Train. I don't know. I'm sure she was grammatically correct. Now I'm trying to pull it up, and Wow, some of her stuff, it's not coming up on the thing. Let me see if I can find it this way. Anyway, I just want to play you a couple of little snippets. If love was a train. And anyway, so the record company back in the those days when... hold on. You know, hold on 1 second. Is this the song? Because if it is... Nah, this isn't Michelle Shocked. Anyway, back in those days, there was, record companies would spend a lot of money doing promotions. And so they booked a train from Los Angeles to San Diego and back. And Michelle Shocked played, here we go, performed live on the train going back and forth, and it was pretty awesome. Oh, this is somebody else doing her song. All right, never mind. So anyway, so there was that, Michelle Shocked doing If Love Was a Train, right? Is it on here? No. Okay, here we go. This should be it, just so you can hear her. Right. And so ever since then, I had been a fan. I was on the train, got to meet her then. And over the years, I interviewed Michelle Shocked a number of times. Now, she forget it. This video is not going to work. Anyway, over the years, Michelle Shocked, came in on the air with me a number of times. I always liked her. And obviously, I don't know, 6-7 years ago now, I moved into the talk radio world. And, then the Occupy movement popped up, right? And a year or two ago, Michelle Shocked was participating in a thing called Occupy the Rose Bowl. And she was leading a band, you know, of their alternative parade. And her name was on the press release, and so I emailed her. And she got right back to me and came on the air with me on the Randy Rhoads Show to talk about this. So that's why when I awoke yesterday morning to tweets about Michelle Shocked going on an anti-gay rant at a show in San Francisco, of all places, I was shocked. I was like, seriously? And so... I emailed Michelle and I texted her and I called her and left a voicemail message. And, I said, look, I want to have you on my show because, I want to talk about this. And honestly, I've gotten tweets on both sides, people saying, why do you want to give this bigot any more airtime to spew her hate? And others saying, I'm interested to hear what she has to say. You know, I'm interested to hear what she has to say. And sure enough, last night, I got a tweet back from Michelle. It just says, hey, Nikki, after all you've done for me over the years, I owe you that interview. And she said, Friday, 3 Pacific time? Well, you know, I don't do a show on Fridays. And so I tweeted her back because that's what she answered. She didn't answer the email. She didn't answer the phone message. She didn't answer the text or, anything else except that. So I tweeted back and I said, well, you know, I don't do a show on Fridays. Anyway, we can do it before then. And of course, people gave me shit over that. But basically, and then I wrote her again. It's, look, if you can't do it before then, I'm happy to do something Friday at 3 Pacific, 12 Eastern. Hey, I'll even do a special live show and air the thing live. You know, hey, I've got nothing else to lose. I do my own show. I can just flip on the streams and do it live. So whatever is good for Michelle. And again, you know, here are some of the tweets I got after her response to me. One is, asked if she's secretly racist as well. Thank you, Bed Sandwich. And then Roash tweeted, I hope you're able to book Michelle. I'll be listening. My head has been spinning out of control with this news. And I'm sort of in that book. You know, I'm in that camp. I'm surprised because, I wouldn't consider Michelle like a great friend, but it's an acquaintance, a professional acquaintance, somebody I've known and liked and of whom I've been a fan for years. It's shocking. Then someone else, Pink Opaque 22, tweeted, "You know who you owe us, the people that bought into your lies. How about an explanation?" Well, you know, that's what I'll get from her, an explanation, because I'm kind of, as I said, shocked. So I went back, and I'll play this. If we get her on Friday, maybe I'll open before we get her on a little early and play this interview with her. It was August 17th, 1994. Again, I was working at a great radio station in Los Angeles that isn't around anymore. It was KSCA at that time, FM 101.9. And Michelle Schacht came on the air. I'm just going to share a little bit of it with you right now.
And we're here. We've moved into the FM 101.9 music hall. And you're hearing Michelle Schacht and a couple of members of Hot House Flowers. And I know Peter O'Toole is here. And I'm going to have to ask you to pronounce
Figgy.
How do you say your name?
Fiachna.
Fiachna.
O'Brien.
They're from Ireland. Right?
How did you know that?
It was just a guess. So you guys are touring together as part of Michelle Schacht's new band.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. It's like, you know.
We're one of Michelle's oldest bands, actually, I think.
It's been fun dating them. But, you know, I mean, they'll be back with their thing later. It's sort of like dating someone that you ain't marrying. That is in a good way,
in a very good way. Mm-hmm. So this started, Michelle and Bart, you know, were coming over to Ireland and England doing some gigs a couple of months ago and phoned up, and I picked up the phone and delighted to hear them and said, well, you know, we're not doing anything at the moment, we're taking a bit of a break because we did all our hectic touring last year and we're just holidaying this year, but what a better way to have a holiday than to come out and play some with Michelle, you know.
No kidding. So how long have you been on the road?
Since March.
All right.
Okay,
so anyway,
I'm
not going to play the whole thing for you now, but just so you know, I've, you know, had this sort of professional relationship with Michelle Schacht for over 20 years. I've interviewed her numerous times. That interview, by the way, was so good. And I'll share it with you, you know, around the time when we get her on, so you can hear why I and other fans of Michelle are so conflicted. Now, if you're wondering what the hell, what did she say? Well, let me read to you from queerty.com. It says, this is an article about what happened on Sunday night. Michelle Schacht, an alt-folk singer, had success in the 80s and 90s, shocked audience members at Yoshi's in San Francisco Sunday night with a homophobic rant that wound up clearing out the club. The crowd had come, presumably, to hear songs like Come a Long Way and On the Greener Side, which got airplay on MTV back in the day. Greener Side was even up for a Video Music Award against Madonna's Vogue. Instead, they were treated to a tirade that allegedly included Schacht announcing, quote, "God hates fags." Matt Penfield, who was live tweeting the show from on stage, called her rant delivered during her second set, quote, "totally sincere and super anti-gay and hateful," end quote. We're still trying to get the full text of her speech, but apparently she told fans, quote, "you can go on Twitter and say Michelle Schacht said God hates fags." Another Twitter user posted that Schacht, quote, said she lives in fear that the world will be destroyed if gays are allowed to marry, end quote. The singer has been open about being a born-again Christian, but was still active in progressive politics. She was arrested at an Occupy LA event in 2011. Raised Mormon, maybe that's the problem, Schacht joined the West Los Angeles or the West Angeles Church of God in the 90s and has been cagey about LGBT issues in recent years, even though she had been frequently identified as a lesbian in the press. A misidentification, Schacht claims. "I am a believer. I am a devout practicing Christian," she told Edge on the Net in 2008. "I don't like the ring of that because I know so many people who profess the faith and I look at their social conscience and I can't see how they reconcile their faith with their politics." In that same 2008 interview, she confessed to some, quote, "inconvenient truths," like how the Bible teaches homosexuality is immoral. Quote, "but homosexuality is no more or less a sin than fornication," and I'm a fornicator with a capital F. That's not the, capital F, end quote. And then I look to the comment. I think she deserves to be heard. And look, regular listeners of the show, you know me well enough to know that, I can ask a tough question or two. So as of right now, Michelle Schacht will join me for a special interview on Friday around 12 noon. And if that's when we do it, that's when we do it. And I'll carry it live here at RadioOrNot.com. Deal? Deal. Stay tuned. I will keep you posted on it. I'm really shocked and I'm disturbed again, because this is somebody who I've known and liked for over 20 years. Now, in the wake of this rant, a bunch of dates that she had scheduled were canceled, including McCabe's in Santa Monica, great concert venue. Anyway, stay tuned. We'll get there. But the interesting thing is, when I started the show talking about one step up, two steps back, just yesterday, Hillary Clinton, former Secretary of State and potential presidential candidate in 2016, made a major announcement.
America to continue leading in the world, there is work we must do here at home. That means investing in our people, our economy, our national security. It also means working every day as citizens, as communities, as a country, to live up to our highest ideals and continue our long march to a more perfect union. LGBT Americans are our colleagues, our teachers, our soldiers, our friends, our loved ones. And they are full and equal citizens and deserve the rights of citizenship. That includes marriage. That's why I support marriage for lesbian and gay couples. I support it personally and as a matter of policy and law, embedded in a broader effort to advance equality and opportunity for LGBT Americans and all Americans. Like so many others, my personal views have been shaped over time by people I have known and loved, by my experience representing our nation on the world stage, my devotion to law and human rights, and the guiding principles of my faith. Marriage, after all, is a fundamental building block of our society, a great joy and, yes, a great responsibility. A few years ago, Bill and I celebrated as our own daughter married the love of her life, and I wish every parent that same joy. To deny the opportunity to any of our daughters and sons solely on the basis of who they are and who they love is to deny them the chance to live up to their own God-given potential.
You know what? Good for her. This should have come a lot earlier, but good for her. Okay, so that's Hillary Clinton. You know, the thing... Oh, cool. I'm so bit. So 3 p.m. Pacific, you're right. Cool, 11 gifts just tweeted to me. That would be 6 p.m. Eastern, not noon. Duh. See, I always get screwed up with the time changes. Right. So a 3 p.m. Pacific on Friday would be 6 p.m. Eastern. Okay. So, yes. So if that's when Michelle Schacht wants to do the interview, that's when we'll do it. God, I'm so stupid. I'd be calling her at 12 noon. All right. So, I'll let you know either way. I'll let you know here on the show. I'll let you know via Twitter. We'll do all that. Back to Hillary Clinton and Michelle Schacht. If the reason she's spewing this homophobic stuff is because she found religion, well, doesn't that go against all the tenets of Christianity? Love one another, do one to others. The whole thing is just, it just makes no sense. Mike M. in the chat room. Thank you, Mike, for being my proxy computer here. Mike M. just tweeted. He did a little research while we were talking here. He said the second set, talking about Michelle Schola Sunday night, second set appeared primed for her to deliver her hateful message, at least according to Christine Penfield, whose husband, Matt, volunteered to live tweet the show from backstage for Michelle Schacht. And then he went to look at the shows that she had scheduled that were booked. And here's the schedule. March 23rd in Los Angeles, that's actually Santa Monica, McCabe's, canceled. Santa Cruz, California on the 28th, Moe's Alley, canceled. March 29th, Novato, California, Hop Monk Tavern, canceled. April 24th, Winters, California, Palms Playhouse, canceled. April 25th, Portland, Oregon, Alberta Rose Theater, canceled. April 26th, Seattle, Meander's Kitchen, canceled. April 27th, Eugene, Oregon, Cosmic, canceled. May 3rd, Boulder, Colorado, the E-Town Radio Show, canceled. May 4th, Madison, Wisconsin, Harmony Bar, tickets still available. Wonder how long that'll last. May 5th, Evanston, Indiana, Evanston Space, canceled. So, and again, the response I got from Michelle when I asked her, and again, I've got her cell phone number. So I had called and left a message because it went right to voicemail. I had texted her. I sent her an email because I have her email address at which we have conversed before. What's interesting is I never tweeted her. She's not following me on Twitter, but I was engaged in other Twitter conversations with my friend Angie Coiro, who actually lives in San Francisco, and Tom Tomorrow, the cartoonist. And so actually Michelle responded to my Twitter conversation with Angie and Tom Tomorrow. And when she said, you know, she actually responded to the three of us and she said, "Hey, Nikki," I'm surprised she actually called me Nikki and spelled it right because that was a name. "After all you've done for me over the years, I owe you that interview Friday, 3 Pacific." So it is, unless we reschedule it to a time when I'm on, we will do it Friday, 3 Pacific. And I'll come back on and do a live show here. Okay. Oh, her Facebook page is down. It says content not available. You know, look, I'm sure she's going through some tough stuff right now. Dava Jean just tweeted, a difference between civil rights, equality, and one's own spiritual beliefs. Our government must be compelled to treat all the same despite religion. I agree. But my point is, as I call out, what's his name? The hateful piece of shit. Pat Robertson, for the hateful things that he says under the guise of a man of God. You know, it's antithetical to everything religion tells you. If you are a born-again Christian and you follow Jesus Christ, and I don't, I'm not. But again, I'm more Christian than these people who pretend, who put themselves out there as Christians and say, you know, and who spew hateful rhetoric. That's where the disconnect is. So, to be continued. All right. I'm going to take a break here because when we talk about hateful rhetoric, what springs to mind? CPAC! And I know we covered CPAC a lot yesterday, and today will be the end of it. But my friend Adele Stan, who writes for alternet.org, and covers the right, was there. She's got a piece up at Alternet that I'll link on the blog today at radioornot.com. It's called 10 Crazy Things Heard at CPAC, the Giant Right-Wing Confab. And she writes that she just picked a random 10. These are not the 10 most crazy things she heard, just a random 10. So we'll hear a little bit of audio. We'll have a chat with Adele Stan. And I find it interesting that in the wake of the Steubenville rape verdict, this actually happened before then, but Steven Crowder, who I guess is supposed to be funny, he bills himself as a comedian, he told this joke at CPAC.
By the way, in breaking news, Ashley Judd just tweeted that buying Apple products again is akin to rape from her iPhone. Rape, right? Well, now she knows how my brain felt after Divine Secrets of the Yaya Sisterhood. But,
What?
We're bringing up... Oh, she said it. What is this obsession Ashley Judd and rape. It's pretty unnerving. This next guy, there's so much you can say about him.
Yeah, they didn't even laugh at that. Maybe they have more of a conscience than he did. I don't know. All right, so we'll talk about other distasteful things from CPAC when we return with Alternet's Adele Stan next. Don't go away. I'm Nicole Sandler. It is radio. Or not.
Who paid for Obama's inaugural festivities? I'll tell you why we don't know today on Hightower Radio. Back in 2010, President Obama declared, "I don't think American elections should be bankrolled by America's most powerful interests." But that was so 2010. By 2013, the mist of corporate money has fogged over Team Obama's commitment to such ethical niceties. For example, take a squint at all the special interests that paid $50 million for his January inaugural festivities. Except, you can't. While the White House pledged that it would put the names of every donor online so people could see that there's no conflict of interest, that's all they disclosed. Just names of individuals. No info on where they live, what corporation they represent, or how much they gave. Even the highly skilled watchdogs of the Sunlight Foundation have been unable to identify 40% of the individuals. They have traced some donors back to such powerful interests as AT&T, Coca-Cola, FedEx, and Microsoft, but they have no clue how much these interests paid, i.e., how much presidential favor they purchased. And now, another layer of fog has descended over the White House. The Obamacans have set up a dark money haven called Organizing for Action, again, making a show of transparency by pledging to issue quarterly lists of donors. But the listings will not include the donor's corporate connection. And why quarterly? Why not reveal the names online the moment the checks arrive? Plus, some checks from corporate executives will be bundled, but OFA will not disclose the corporations delivering the bundles. OFA donors will have access to special White House briefings. But, as the Sunlight Group asks, will someone who gives $50 be invited, or just those giving $50,000 and up? I think you can guess how that'll come down. This is Jim Hightower saying, to help oppose this sad end run around common ethics, go to sunlightfoundation.com.
If you'd like more of Jim Hightower's real populism, check out the Hightower Lowdown. Jim's monthly newsletter gives you the real lowdown on which corporations, by name, are doing what to the middle class, our environment, and our democracy. Each month, the Hightower Lowdown brings you facts you didn't know, along with actions you can take to fight back. It also comes with a sense of humor. Hightower believes we can fight the gods and still have fun. Plus, get this, it's cheap. Only $15 brings you 12 issues a year. For real populism, go to hightowerlowdown.org.
Of terrestrial radio. Internet radio will not succeed. You will continue listening to sports, right-wing talk, and mayonnaise FM. If you disobey, we will punish you with more right-wing talk, sports, and mayonnaise FM. We are corporate, ergo, we are never wrong. Listen and obey. Listen and obey.
Shut it down, evil foe, for I am SoFloRadio.com, and I'm here to give back what people want to hear. A variety of entertainment, fresh music, comedy, and different points of view.
I own you!
Oh, your fart-radiating suit and tie don't frighten me, old chum. Behold the power of SoFloRadio.com.
My balls are falling off.
You only had one, my evil friend. There. Now you'll have to squat to pee.
SoFloRadio.com. Castrating terrestrial radio. One ball at a time.
I'm David Schuster, and this is the Nicole Sandler Show on RadioOrNot.com.
Ah, thank you, David. It is. And, well, let's get Adele Stan on, shall we? Addie Stan is the Washington correspondent for Alternet there at alternet.org. And, well, she gets to cover the right wingers. Well, she's the Washington correspondent, so she covers all of them. But Washington seems to be overrun with right wingers. And she just, well, the trip to CPAC didn't take her very far because it was just...
Adele Stan.
Hey, Adele, it's Nicole Sandler calling.
Hi, how are you?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm okay.
Good. Thank you so much for coming on with us this morning. Have you recovered yet from your journey into right-wing world?
Just barely. It's been a little slow getting out of bed in the morning.
Oh, I'll bet. You know, there's just so much craziness you can take in one sitting. And they seem to... how many years have you gone to CPAC?
Oh... I have to say, I think four.
Wow.
I think four.
And do they seem to try to...
I've been going to the religious right
conferences
for much, much longer,
wow.
for more than a decade.
Okay, that's even worse. And I want to go there because we've been sort of talking about how religion just, especially of the evangelical sort, any religious zealot, and it doesn't really matter what religion the zealotry is in, it just seems to ratchet up the crazy. But for a moment, let's talk CPAC. Does it seem like they try to out crazy themselves a little more each year, maybe in the quest of getting more and more media attention?
No, I think it's just that as the Republican Party, and I've made this case actually on Washington Monthly this weekend, as the Republican Party and CPAC become virtually the same thing,
mm-hmm.
they're attracting more mainstream media to the conference, and so, and plus we have had a proliferation of liberal media, progressive media in the space, so I think
right.
that you're just getting a lot more reporting.
Yeah, you know, it's insane, and I know I've seen you at Netroots Nation before. Netroots Nation, maybe it's not a fit analogy, but they get virtually no coverage except for just some straight video feeds on C-SPAN, which is good, but the
mm-hmm.
networks don't come out and cover it.
Well, here's the thing about the media. The mainstream media, the corporate media, you know, there's always a belief on one side or the other that the media are feeding the line of the opposition. But really what media are in favor of, where their bias lies, is in finding things that look new.
Mm-hmm.
And when progressives do what they do, it doesn't look new because they've been doing it for a long time.
Right.
So you've got that. You also have this sort of self censorship in mainstream media, having been called liberal media for so long, that I think there's also a hesitancy to appear to be in the tank, quote unquote, you know, with liberals and progressives. So I think you have those things going on, but there is a phenomenon going on in CPAC that does look bright and shiny and new, and actually it's really not all that new, but the right is brilliant with rebranding itself constantly. And so there's always this sense that if you don't show up, you're going to miss something.
I guess, I suppose. Again, I've never been to CPAC, but I've seen enough of the coverage to see that it's, you know, it seems like a parade of crazies. And maybe, you know, Netroots is just not crazy enough. Although, you know, I got to say, I pulled this clip from Joe Scarborough the other day. Let me see. I don't want to play the whole thing. Let me see if I can cue into it, where he tries
sure.
to say, you know, do that false equivalency thing.
But the core issue of small government at home and a restrained foreign policy abroad, I will sometimes...
It's just not a realistic setting.
...embrace people for symbolic purposes.
Okay. Well,
Joe doesn't like
good.
Paper money either.
Yeah, that's not it. He was talking about CPAC, and he didn't like, you know, the characterization of this, you know, gathering of the nut jobs. And then he went on to this thing, you know, the false equivalency rant. And I've seen liberal gatherings where they, you know, they digressed into violence. And it's like, you know what?
Where?
Yeah, that's what I say. Yeah, maybe it's some Occupy protests where there were agent provocateurs. Because, as I said when we talked about this yesterday, you know, the one directive, the one rule that Occupy had was, you know, nonviolence.
Right.
So,
right.
yeah,
I agree. There's a total false equivalency going on right there. And, you know, how can you disagree with the characterization of people when you're quoting them directly, Nicole? I mean, you know, the crazy was not like something that was like coming out of the mouths of, you know, progressive media as they reported this. This is like there's video, there's quotations. I have a piece about Alternate right now, which is 10 crazy things I heard at CPAC.
Right, and the thing is, they weren't even like the 10 craziest. These are just 10 random things you came up with, right?
Right, it's just sort of what I came across in my travels. I didn't, you know, do a big search. I didn't listen to all gazillion hours of audio that I collected. These are just the ones that kind of stuck with me. Like the woman who said that, you know, cloth grocery bags will kill you.
Yeah, right. Right.
The panelist at a breakout session who laid at the feet of women the problem with single-parent households because, he said, these women are deciding to have babies on their own on the booty call. Oh, I mean, you know, I'm not making this up. There was incredible footage collected by Think Progress of a panel on racism that turned into like a platform for a white supremacist who made the assertion that, you know, slaves, that African Americans should have been grateful for the experience of slavery because they got free housing and food.
Right. And then at the end of this, this exchange, he was heard muttering under his breath, why can't we just have segregation?
Right.
Wow.
So, I mean, I don't know. I don't see equivalent crazy.
No.
In that route.
No, and maybe that's why it doesn't get the media coverage, because it doesn't support their narrative that, those leftists, they're, you know, they're so crazy. Well, no, it doesn't support that. And I guess showing this crazy stuff generates ratings.
Well, I think there's probably an element to that, although I really honestly believe that this is really intended for the Republican base, and these are the messages that the whole enormous, ginormous right-wing infrastructure, including all of those quote-unquote think tanks and organizations, you know, are hoping to have the base absorb. And that is what the whole deal is about. I mean, as Phyllis Schlafly said, the thing to do is for the right to take over the Republican Party as they did in 1980. And so you feed this stuff to the base, you get the base riled up. The base is the people who vote in primaries and who are more inclined to run for positions in the party if they're directed to take over the party, and there you go.
Well, that's the thing. You know, it is the sort of fringe who does vote in the primary, these Tea Partiers who you know, they're the ones who vote in the primary. So they determine who the candidate is going to be. And you have someone like Lindsey Graham, who, if I remember correctly, he used to be a somewhat reasonable Republican. Right?
He's
just as crazy as the rest of them. And it's because, well, gee, he's up for re-election in 2014. And he's afraid of being primaried from the right.
Right, and this is a problem that they really don't know how to fix. If you look at a big report that Reince Priebus unveiled yesterday, you know, they call it their postmortem on the election. I mean, he's saying that, well, maybe if we have shorter primaries, we won't have the candidates getting so beat up and being so weak when it comes time for a general. Excuse me, I mean, the problem is not, and if we fix our messaging,
we need better PR.
It's the base.
Yes. Well, it is not the messaging, but their message. It's what they stand for. And maybe, Maybe Reince Priebus did one thing right here, which was the first day back after CPAC and after all this crazy, you know, narrative is going around, and we have the video, and I'll play some audio in a few minutes that leaves you scratching your head. Maybe the one smart thing he did was releasing this on Monday morning to try to get the attention off of all the craziness that went on over the weekend.
Oh, yeah, I don't think that timing was at all accidental.
Right.
I think it was exactly what he wanted to
but
do.
But is it very smart to be calling it the GOP autopsy? You know, I mean, it's like, come on, you may want to say the postmortem on the election,
right,
but to call
right.
it that, when I first heard that, I'm like, okay, who came up with that name?
Talk and about I was bad told messaging,
it was
right?
them, right?
He wasn't kidding. They needed messaging help too.
No kidding. So, you know, so we find out they're going to spend millions on a new, you know, PR push, on a new marketing campaign. Well, first of all, if you want to spend millions, how about, you know, feeding the hungry and housing the homeless instead
well,
of, you know, spending it on,
those
you know,
people should be, you know, pulling themselves by their own darn bootstraps, Nicole.
Damn it. Of course. No, you don't feed someone who's hungry. You teach them to fish. Damn it.
Right.
Right. Oh, my. Because that
in
just
those,
makes
in
them
In those
dependent.
Waters that don't need environmental
right.
regulation.
Right. Or like here in Florida.
They're full of contaminated plastic.
The manatees are dying on both coasts of Florida. Oh, but, you know, don't look that way. There's nothing wrong with the water. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a thing. It's quite a time in America.
I call
politics.
It opposite world. So, Adele Stan, you talk about you've been to some of their, you know, the religious right conferences, which I have to think are a bit more crazy. I opened the show talking about something that's really disconcerting to me. I'm a music fan. I come from music radio, from, you know, from a format that doesn't... that isn't in most places, and that's why I'm doing talk radio these days.
Gotcha,
and, of course,
yeah.
I'm doing progressive talk radio, which, of course, is also being killed around the nation.
Right.
You know, I guess I'm not in the mainstream here.
Y'all support Nicole.
Right? Yeah. So, but there's an artist who I had been playing on the air since her first record, named Michelle Schacht.
Oh, I love Michelle Schacht.
Well, did you hear what happened this weekend?
No, I did not.
See, you were at CPAC.
I was in CPAC land, yeah.
Right. Sunday night, Michelle Schacht was doing a show at Yoshi's in San Francisco and decided to go onto a major anti-gay rant in which she said that the world will be destroyed if gays are allowed to marry.
Michelle Schacht said that?
Yes, and, you know, said, here's a quote, you can go on Twitter and say, Michelle Schacht said, God hates fags. And basically, everybody walked out. The owner of the club, who is a gay man, pulled the plug, said, get the fuck out of here. And all her dates coming up have been canceled. And, you know, so I've been, you know, tweeting about this. Now, I know Michelle. I've known her for 25 years. I've
Where
interviewed her
from?
Numerous times. Well, she is a born-again Christian. She joined this an African-American church in Los Angeles, and at the time, because I've even asked her about it's for the music. I mean, she did a gospel album, but
right.
I guess the stuff
and
got
we could
to
say
her.
That there are a lot of African-American churches, at least in my area, that do support gay rights.
Oh, of course, right. Yeah. But I guess, you know, this one didn't. She turned into an evangelical born-again Christian who, you know, doesn't believe... I don't know. So I called her. I went right to voicemail, left a message. I texted her. I emailed her, an email account that we have conversed on before. But it's interesting that she answered me on Twitter where I didn't write to her, but I was in conversations with others about what had happened. And she responded that, you know, she said, for all you've done for me over the years, I owe you... I owe you an interview. How about Friday afternoon? So, okay. But I'm shocked. See, your response was, well, I love Michelle Schacht. She got arrested at an Occupy thing in 2011. She was part of, Occupy the Rose Bowl parade last year.
Well, I mean, she's always been, you know, we've always thought of her as one of ours.
I know. And that's why it's so,
I've always appreciated that she brought to sort of the alt folk world, this sensibility of roots music.
Yes,
you know. The blues, the gospel, all of that.
I know. Yeah. I played a little bit of an interview I did with her back in 1994 in Los Angeles, a live performance on the air, and she was touring. It was Michelle Schacht and some of the members of Hot House Flowers, and it was just so musically amazing. And she always came across as this very genuine, good person, and that's why I'm so shocked. And so hopefully she will come on with me. I'll do a special broadcast on Friday and talk to her. But again, here's this disconnect with fundamentalists, with evangelicals, and again, religious zealots, and I'll say of any religion, because look, I'm a non-practicing Jew, but it's the ultra orthodox crazy Jews who I think who are so dismissive of others, who are so unaccepting of people who are different than they are. It's the Muslim, the Islamic zealots that are the, you know, the ones who go on religious fatwas. It's the crusaders, the Christian, you know, who go against everything that Christ taught. I mean, I constantly rail on Pat Robertson and say I'm more Christian than he is because he's a hateful piece of shit. So, you know, so I can only imagine how, you know, these religious conferences that you go to, the right wing evangelicals, you know, what Ralph Reed's their conferences, and how they don't preach what Jesus preached at all.
Right. This is true. This is true. But in terms of comparing the crazy, I don't know that you can say that they are more crazy. They're different kind of crazy. At CPAC, you have all of these libertarians and neo-libertarians, and I count the Rand Paul, Ron Paul brand of politics neo-libertarianism, uh-huh, because it does not encompass individual rights for women, and the like. So libertarianism, they are some hard drinking folk. When you go to a religious right conference, there's no alcohol.
Right.
So, you know, people may be kind of nuts in terms of what they believe by our perception, but they're pretty well behaved, in individual interactions. When you go to CPAC, I mean, it is just raucous and wild. Like, for instance, at in some ways, CPAC is more fun because of that. I mean, the sartorial expression is a little more far-ranging. As Lisette Garcia, who works for Judicial Watch, said to me, actually said to a room full of people, I love CPAC. No, nowhere else have I ever seen so many yarmulkes and miniskirts in the same place. CPAC represents the whole range of the right. So I think that the atmosphere at CPAC is far more circus-like than you get at a religious right conference.
Okay, well, I'll get you that. I mean, I'm just thinking the hypocrisy, you know, in people who are so embedded in any church, from the Catholic Church, who, you know, protects priests. I mean, they're supposed to be the one person you can trust out of anybody, who rape little boys, to
betray children.
Right? Yes. And, you know, again, I go to Pat Robertson, who makes fortunes asking people who are, you know, sick at home, infirmed in front of their TV, to send him money. Look, I adopted a child from an orphanage in Kazakhstan, and Pat Robertson dared to go on his TV show and say, you don't adopt those children. They're damaged goods. I mean, you know, send them. Oh, you never heard that?
That's a Robertsonian quotation I had missed.
I will find it for you as we're talking, because it's one of my favorites, and that's what prompted me to, you know, call him, I think, the most despicable human being of 2012. How dare he? He's supposed to be a man of God, and you say, don't take them into your home.
Right,
no, send them money, but don't adopt them.
Amazing. Your feelings about what kind of Christian he is not is right on the money. I mean, Jesus told everybody.
Susan says,
I'm
a mother three.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Here's the quote. Here, let me just play this clip for you. It's a little over a minute. Here
Susan says, I'm the mother of three adopted girls. I find the men I date are okay when I tell them I have three daughters, but when they find out that they're adopted and from three different countries and not my own biological children, they don't want to date anymore. Whether I tell them up front or after a couple dates, all the men are reacting the same way. They say they could be okay if the girls were, you know, biological children and came with child support. Why are these men reacting this way? Can I answer? Because they're, I was going to say dogs.
Don't you insult my
I'm not going to say dogs, but they are, that's just wrong on every level.
No, it's not wrong.
It is wrong.
I mean, a man doesn't want to take on the United Nations, and this woman's got all these various children and a blended family. I mean, what is it? And you don't know what problems are. I'm serious. I've got a dear friend, adopted some little kid from an orphanage down in Columbia. Child had brain damage. You know, grew up weird. And you just never know what's been done to a child before you get that child. What kind of sexual abuse it's been, what kind of cruelty, what kind of food deprivation, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
So don't help them.
You're not a dog because you don't want to take on that responsibility. You don't have to take on somebody else's problems. I mean, you really don't. You can go help people. You could minister to people. We minister to orphans all over the world, thousands of them. We love orphans. We love helping people. But that doesn't necessarily mean that I'm going to take all the orphans around the world into my home. And I think, you know, okay, let's get the next
That's
question.
True.
I'm in trouble.
Yeah. Good Christian
Whoa.
Man. Right. Family values. Right. And this man has the audacity to say God talks to him.
Right.
That's my problem.
You know.
Right? And
that's pretty astonishing, but it's not surprising. A guy who blames hurricanes on, you know,
the gay.
And gays,
right?
You know.
Yeah, right.
Oh, poor Michelle Schott.
I know, right? So I can't wait to talk to her because I know she's better than that. I think, you know, perhaps this church she's in is some kind of a cult.
That's generally where you get that kind of language from, you know.
Yep.
The whole God hates fags language.
Right.
You know?
Right. Yeah. So she's been brainwashed, and you know, it's really, really, really sad.
The one thing I think when we're inclined to kind of figure out Michelle Schott and what happened to her and maybe have some sympathy if she's fallen into a cult, I think that we should kind of think about some of the rank and file followers of the religious right in the same way and think about what it is they have been brainwashed with.
I tend to think of people who are so entrenched in the church and they believe this stuff. The people who are worshiping the new pope and who stand by the Catholic Church after all that's been done and just figure these are just such weak people. They don't have the strength to stand up on their own and say, this is wrong. And I do, you know, liken them to these Republicans who are, you know, poor, who are, you know, who need Social Security and Medicare, who need health care, who will benefit by Obamacare and would so benefit by a public option or Medicare for all, who defend these Republicans and will vote against their own best interests year after year after year.
Yeah, I mean, it's just kind of amazing. But that it goes to what the other piece of this, especially in the religious right, but of the right in general, I think, Nicole, is that that this is a movement of cultural identity, you know, especially on the religious right.
Yeah.
I mean, this is a movement of cultural identity, and it's about, you know, not only being white and Christian, and it's very much about that, representing that as the true America. And, you know, the roots of this movement are among people who do have very, you know, long-standing roots in the United States, who, you know, trumpet their ties to the big wars on American soil, both the American Revolution and the Civil War. So I think that, you know, those are powerful, those are powerful qualifiers. I mean, I know for me, myself, I do not practice Catholicism anymore, but I will never convert. Because this is the culture that shaped me. It's my cultural identity. It's my family's identity. I just don't practice, and I speak my mind about the church. But, you know, they're going to have to throw me out.
Uh-huh. Oh, that's interesting. See, and I was raised Jewish. I've never, I came from a non-religious family. You know, we have three girls, and if there was a boy in the family, the boy probably would have been bar mitzvahed, but we had three girls, and there was no bat mitzvah, although now, you know, in any even relatively observant Jewish family, that's sort of a given. But I'm not doing that to my daughter, and in fact, she, you know, she is like me. She questions God. I mean, but she believes in treating others as you would have them treat you. And I thought that was what Jesus's teachings were all about.
Yeah, right. You know? Oh, you're not going to get an argument from me.
Right. I know. I just think we need to be good to one another. And more, the more religious the person is, it seems to be the less they adhere to those teachings. And it's
I do think this, though. I think there's a generational shift in the right away from the religious right views and toward the Rand Paul neo-libertarian
views. Right. Now, Rand Paul, and in fact, we're bringing it full circle back to CPAC because we only got a couple of minutes left. Adele Stan is with us. She writes for alternet.org, and she's on Twitter at Addie Stan, and I'll have links to everything up on my blog at radioornot.com after the show. Rand Paul won the straw poll at CPAC, following in his father's footsteps, because Ron Paul had always won. Jeb Bush asked to be taken out of it, right? But there's the disconnect, because the establishment Republican Party, they don't want Rand Paul. In fact, John McCain excoriated Rand Paul after the filibuster and then took it back.
As a wacko bird.
Right, but and then took it back. Oh, I didn't mean to say he's a wacko bird. Right. Can we say senile? The establishment Republican Party doesn't want the Rand Pauls, yet it's the Rand Pauls. You know, it seems like the Republican Party is moving towards libertarianism as the, you know, the establishment Democratic Party is moving towards republicanism.
that's a good observation. But yes, I would say that, you know, and let's qualify this. It's neo-libertarianism.
Yeah.
Rand Paul's position on abortion, and listen up, you progressive men who, mm-hmm. you know, who
think
fanboy him,
yeah, right.
Is exactly the same as Todd Akin's, is exactly the same as Richard Murdoch's. There is no daylight between them.
No, in fact, he just introduced, I think, a fetal personhood bill that would outlaw abortion, period, end of story.
Absolutely. Yep. And a heartbeat bill and all kinds of stuff. And he, of course, believes private property rights trump, you know, civil rights in terms of desegregation. So, I mean, this is who you're dealing with. So it's neo-libertarianism, but, you know, it's softer on the issues of gay rights, you know. It's softer, and of course it opposes the war on drugs and the mass incarceration for different reasons than progressives
do. Right, exactly.
Mostly because it involves the money of taxpayers. But
right.
But nonetheless, it can appear attractive to a certain segment of the progressive movement.
Yeah, which is sad. And when I hear otherwise, intelligent people talk about Ron Paul and Rand Paul, it's like, oh no. No, you need to do a little more reading.
Right.
You are not informed. And that's, I guess, our job, yours at Alternet, mine here on the radio. Adele Stan, you do such great work. I thank you so much for coming on today. Will you be at Netroots Nation?
I'm hoping to get there. We'll see how it all pans out.
I know how it is. It's tough for us East Coasters that, you know,
Alton has a great staff on the West Coast. So
yes.
I would imagine those folks get first dibs.
Right. All right. Well, I hope you'll be there. Even if not, we need to do this more often because I so enjoy talking with you.
Oh, it was wonderful to be on with you, Nicole. Thanks
you
so
too.
Much
thank,
for having me.
Thank you. Adele Stan, bye-bye. Find her at alternet.org on the Twitters, Addie Stan. She is the Washington correspondent for Alternet, and she gets to cover a lot of this right-wing stuff. I should have asked her. Oh, I know. You know, usually the right-wingers, when Netroots Nation is going on, they have their Right Online conference, and they always schedule it in the same city that Netroots Nation was at the same time, because they don't have an original thought. And but now Raven Brooks and the people at Netroots got smart, and they put no compete clauses into all their contracts. So basically, we will come to your city, but you can't have basically right online coming at the same time. So last year was the first time that went into effect. Netroots was in Providence, Rhode Island, and the right online people, because, you know, they're so virtuous, they went back to Vegas, which the first Netroots I ever went to was in Las Vegas. And of course, they were there trying to crash our party. Speaking of Netroots Nation, it happens this year, as we said, in San Jose from June 20th to the 23rd. I've decided I'm going regardless. Now, the first 2 years I went, I went courtesy of Democracy for America, who does a scholarship thing. They have a scholarship program. I won a scholarship thanks to listeners' votes. I'm no longer eligible for that. And so I have to, you know, pay my own way, which is kind of difficult. So if you can help support the show going to Netroots Nation, go to radioornot.com, and your support will be put to good use, I promise. I read the news today. All right, that sound means that it's time for the news. For that, we turn to the Talk Radio News Service. They are at talkradionews.com. Good morning. Who's on the line today?
It's Bob Ney. How are you?
Hey, Bob. I'm doing well. I got to say, I'm about a little more than halfway through your book. It's in the other room right now, so I can't hold it up for the camera. And it's so good. I can't wait to talk to you about it, but we're going to put it off. You're going to join me on the show Thursday.
Yes, I'm going to be scheduled with you.
We're scheduled. We're scheduled for this Thursday, in fact, right after the news. So at about 11:20 or so on Thursday, we'll talk. There are a lot of things that I did not know about you that I was pleasantly surprised to learn. And so we'll do that on Thursday. So Bob Ney will join us, talk about his new book, Sideswiped, it's called, right?
Yes, Sideswiped.
All right, can't wait. All right, but today you're calling with the Talk Radio News Service to tell us what's going on. What is happening today?
Well, the talk of the town, well, there's a lot of things. You know, the Pope is being installed, of course, worldwide issue. President is on his way to Israel. That will be kind of a landmine there. You know, the Israelis are going to push on him, but he's going to meet with the Palestinians, and they're divided. So that'll be a little bit of a hairy trip over there. In the nation's capital, just a quick rundown, March 27th is the, quote, shutdown date for the government, but the Republicans have a bipartisan support on a bill, not totally, not all of them, but enough of them that they will continue to October the 1st. The House will follow suit with that. The big news is the CPAC Conservative Convention, and they came out to talk about, you know, what do they do about the Republican Party, how do they change it. And I have to note to you, Nicole, because I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, change it by taking the spokespeople and slap them. they're calling the ideas, they're looking at the autopsy report. That was the title. They did an autopsy report.
Yes, I know.
Well, on the
we were just talking. I had Adele Stan on, who writes for Alternet, and she reported on CPAC. She was there. And I understand. I said the one thing Reince Priebus did well that was smart on his part was to change the conversation away from the CPAC crazies and issue this report. But he called it the GOP autopsy. I mean, not really smart.
I know. So, you know, that was it just amazed me. But a lot of things are happening. Rand Paul is giving an immigration speech today. Now that may doom him amongst the, quote, conservatives, but of course a conservative didn't win the nomination. Mitt Romney won it, not Rick Santorum, but they wouldn't let Mitt Romney be Mitt Romney.
Right.
So the party's struggling. Rob Portman, my Ohio senator, has reversed himself on gay marriage.
Yeah.
Republicans ought to leave him alone. His son came to he and his wife and said he was gay, and so Senator Portman, after years and years of holding one position, has changed his mind. Pure and simple, it's a personal thing.
Right. Well, his son is gay, and you know, it's interesting timing, though, that he waited until after he was...
Oh, no question.
Yeah, but that's everything, you know, politics...
Well, an interesting question. Wouldn't you like to have been a fly on the wall? He told Romney's people this.
Oh, that his son was gay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
He told, from what I understand from friends of mine, and I failed to see this in print, but he vetted this to Romney's people that his son was gay to let them know, you know, so there was no surprise there. Now, the big question in everybody's mind is that why he wasn't picked? You know, obviously.
And very possible.
So the party is morphing, but the terminology of autopsy report, I thought, was just a horrible way to begin a new process of a new day within the party.
Right.
Hillary Clinton has reversed herself on gay marriage, which I think is a big indicator of 2016.
Do you? Okay. Well, we shall see. But it was a beautiful video that she released, actually in conjunction with the Human Rights Coalition. And I played a little bit of it earlier. It is interesting. You know, some say, I hate that phrase, but some say how interesting that, you know, she comes out with this, again, in light of the possibility that she'll run in 2016, the week of the anniversary, the 10th anniversary of the war in Iraq, which she voted for. But Victoria Jones yesterday of the Talk Radio News Service pointed out, well, even more pertinent, perhaps, is the fact that the Supreme Court will be hearing the challenge to DOMA and Prop 8 in a couple of weeks. So there's
and
that,
it's changing, you know, around rapidly. I have to note one news story that I was personally involved with, and I wanted to note it.
Yeah.
In a sense, I created an elections commission with Steny Hoyer and the Help America Vote Act. The elections commission went against the Arizona law. And now the Arizona Attorney General is in the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court seems to be siding with the election decision that Arizona cannot go against the federal statutes of how you say whether or not you are an illegal or legal citizen of America. So that was just, I thought, an interesting little side note. We created where you sign whether you're a citizen with no other extraordinary means. You just sign if you are. Arizona took it farther for providing proof.
Right. You know, and this is one of the things that I certainly want to talk with you about on Thursday, which is the way the Republican Party has devolved since you left Congress. And their look, your legacy bill was the Help America Vote Act, where you wanted to make it easier for people to register to vote and to actually vote. And now your party is responsible for all of this voter suppression stuff through Alec, who you say that you worked with, to try to keep people from registering, from voting.
I thought it was interesting. The law that I authored and most Republicans voted for ended up creating an elections commission, which went against Arizona.
Uh-huh.
And I thought that was fascinating when I read the Supreme Court case. You know, I thought that was interesting.
It is.
But, yeah, things morph and change. But that's the big rundown in D.C. today, so everybody's just scrambling to see where they want to be on what issues of what day.
Right. One other question for you, Bob Ney, is your district, your former congressional district in Ohio, included Steubenville, which has been in the news of late. There's some real disconcerting stuff coming out since, in the moments after the verdict was announced against these two football players, guilty on rape, and there have been death threats tweeted out to the victim from girls in Steubenville. There's such a football culture in that town that these, I hesitate to call them kids because they're young men, 17 and 16 and 17 years old, are so lionized that you know, they're blaming the girl. What's going on there? What are your thoughts about what went on in Steubenville?
Well, I represented Steubenville for years in the Congress, and it's a riverfront town, the home of Dean Martin, Jimmy the Greek, et cetera. And it's a sports valley-dominated, you know, people don't ask you what you do for a living. They'll ask you which high school team did you support.
Uh-huh.
Football is everything and a day over there. And so, yes, there were some, you know, horrible things that came out afterwards and people upset. And then there was a question of the coaches' involvement in this and cover-up. I don't think the story's done. Nicole, I don't think this
story's
done.
Well, in fact, there are two girls were arrested for tweeting out death threats against the victim, Jane Doe. There's that. And the prosecutors are saying that, you know, now they're going after the other people who are complicit, people, other kids and adults who stood by and didn't stop it, who didn't report it, who tweeted out the pictures and other things around the crime. Good. A lot more people should be prosecuted.
it was very divisive in the community. No, I wouldn't say split in half in the community, but just a very, you know, divisive issue. And it ended up that there was some immunity granted to some of the witnesses. That caused a bad feeling down there because some of the witnesses took pictures of the sexual acts, and then they were given immunity. There was a big question about that and the prosecutor handling it. Of course, they brought in a special prosecutor, and the Attorney General of Ohio got pretty directly involved. But again, I think there's more aftermath to come yet. I don't think the story is done.
No, I don't either, and I don't think it should be. It's got to be tough for you watching this go on and, you know, in basically your home state.
It is, and, you know, that county, I used to walk out of there, I used to win that county by 10,000 votes, Jefferson County. That's a county that's just been ravaged and hit with the economy and steel mills, and then you see this happen, and it's really, you know, the county's had enough problems, and now its national focus has been something of such a horrible nature.
Oh, yes, and that's what it will be known for. When you hear Steubenville, you're going to think rape.
Yes.
And perhaps, you know, well, what goes around comes around. Bob Ney of the Talk Radio News Service, and again, programming note, this Thursday, Bob will join me to talk about his new book, Sideswiped, and a lot of things that are surprising me in the reading of it, and I think will surprise the listeners, too. Bob, thank you so much, and I'm enjoying
thank
the
you.
Book. I'll talk to you Thursday.
Thanks.
All right. Bye-bye. All right. Yeah, you know, in addition to... the fact that he represented Steubenville, which, oh, okay, well, that's in the news now. There are some other things, you know, that surprised me. Bob Ney, and I'm not going to go into a lot of it now. We'll do it on Thursday. but he spent time in the late 70s in Iran. He speaks Farsi. And Trita Parsi, Dr. Trita Parsi, who's been on the show before, is a good friend of Bob's. You know, I didn't follow politics back in the during the whole Abramoff scandal days as closely as I do now, or before. Didn't follow it as closely before Abramoff either, and wasn't aware that Bob Ney was such a let's say, you know, a liberal Republican. He voted against the Patriot Act. One of three Republicans who voted against the Patriot Act. I'm guessing Ron Paul was another one. You know, he was for making voting simpler, registration simpler with the HAVA that we just talked about. A lot of things. And he's been so vilified that I really, you know, when the first time he called in for the Talk Radio News Service, I'm like, Bob Ney, why do they have this criminal, you know, right wing nut job calling in? And as I'm reading the book, I realize, no, that's what they wanted us to believe about him. We actually could use more decent Republicans, and it sounds like that's what he was. Mike M. is saying, Nicole, you're going to have me thinking he isn't the whole of evil before George Bush. He isn't the whole of evil. I'm glad I'm reading this book. I think you're... and again, I still have more to go. And he admits his guilt where he was guilty, but he was also really set up by Karl Rove... Karl Rove in the Bush White House. Yeah, we'll get into all of it on Thursday. All right, by the way, speaking of the Talk Radio News Service, let me tell you, Ellen Ratner, who runs Talk Radio News Service, if you didn't already know she was a good person, know it now. In the foreword to the book, he talks about how this book got published and the prodding that came from Ellen and the support and, in fact, the dedication on the book. Let me read it to you. I dedicate this book to my friend Ellen Ratner. You have been my friend, mentor, psychiatrist, specialist enforcer, tough love implementer, travel and adventure planner, and many more aspects that one human being brings to another along their journey. Quote, to the world you may be one person, but to one person you may be the world. You are the world to me, a gift to many others, and you are famous among those who know and love you for your rare ability to do what you say you will. That's pretty nice. All right. So again, Thursday morning, Bob Ney will join us. And if you want to support Talk Radio News Service, well, Ellen's whole thing is goatsfortheoldgoat.com. She's been very supportive of the people of South Sudan, helping them build their lives. And she encourages you to help them by donating a goat. All right. So Mike M. says, I need to get his book. Was he set up like Don Siegelman? In a way, yes. And when you know it's coming from Karl Rove, hello, right? Don't put anything past Karl Rove and his people. All right. We'll take a break and come back with Gotta Laugh from thepoliticalcarnival.net. Don't go away. I'm Nicole Sandler. It's radio. Or not.
This is Matters Minute. I'm Laura Keeter. President Obama has nominated Tom Perez as Secretary of Labor. Right-wing media has seized on this announcement to push false attacks about Perez based on his service in the Justice Department's Civil Rights Division. Here's Rush Limbaugh.
This guy's name is Tom Perez, and he may as well be Hugo Chavez. And that is not an exaggeration. Yep, Tom Perez is his name, and I'll tell you who this guy is. He is the guy in the Department of Justice, in the Civil Rights Division, who made the call not to prosecute the new Black Panthers.
It's true that the Justice Department dismissed a 2008 voter intimidation case involving the new Black Panther Party. However, Perez hadn't been confirmed by the Senate for his position at the Justice Department at the time the case was dismissed. For more on the right-wing myths and the actual facts surrounding Tom Perez and for other stories, please visit MediaMatters.org.
You never know who or what you'll hear when you listen to The Nicole Sandler Show at RadioOrNot.com.
Your view is not being represented in this country because all of our views have been corrupted by money and politics. Remember, 94% of the time, the candidate who raises the most money wins.
That's the fact that we need to drive home constantly. It's all about the money. Dylan Radigan, you rock.
The Nicole Sandler Show, live Monday through Thursdays at 10 a.m. Eastern, or podcast anytime at RadioOrNot.com.
Hey, kids, it's time for the political carnival and Gotta Laugh with the Nicole Sandler Show.
Hold on. I gotta call Laffy. Calling Laffy. I wasn't ready. Ah, you know what? Let's do it again. Start over, shall we? Man.
Hey, kids, it's time for the political carnival and Gotta Laugh with the Nicole Sandler Show.
All right. This time of the week, every week, we talk to Gotta Laugh from thepoliticalcarnival.net and find out, talk about some stories we might otherwise not have gotten to.
Yes, you've reached the CPAC hotline.
Oh, boy.
Press 1 if you think Sarah Palin should keep her big mouth busy doing less talking and more sucking on a big gulp. Press 2 if you think Palin thought the straw poll was about that long cylindrical thing that she stuck in her soda pop.
Ooh.
Press 3 if you think it's time for Ann Coulter to forcibly... Oh, never mind. Who cares about Ann Coulter? Have a nice day.
You know, fuck Ann Coulter. She...
Yeah!
If you didn't hear it, here's Ann Coulter who thinks she's funny. Listen.
But she's not.
Oh, hold on. No, but she's snot.
The old
right,
chiffon
right.
commercial.
But she's not.
The keynote speaker at the Democratic National Convention this year was forcible rapist Bill Clinton.
Was forcible rapist Bill Clinton? What?
You know, what's just as bad is that the audience, other than the gasps you heard, there was laughter and applause that followed that initial, ooh, you know. And so she's getting support from her crowd. So all of these people, probably rape victims are not amused at what they're saying and doing. Two, they're all performance artists. I mean, let's call it what it is. They're trying to sell books. She's trying to sell her book. And it's shock value.
Does she have another book?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
As I recall, she does. Maybe I'm remembering wrong, but I could have sworn. I thought Bill Maher mentioned it. Maybe I'm wrong. But she always has a book. So, if she doesn't have one now, she'll have one in 2 weeks.
Oh, great.
And it's always, you know, like, liberals suck. Liberals are the devil. You
of
know,
course.
Here we are experiencing Steubenville, right?
Right.
And she's making a really horrible... I don't want to call it a joke, but it's a joke about Bill Clinton being a forcible rapist.
Yeah, I think she thought she was being funny. Again, listen to this.
The keynote speaker at the Democratic National Convention this year was forcible rapist Bill Clinton.
Yeah, so you can hear the reaction there. No, not funny. It's like this other moron, Steven Crowder, who I guess bills himself as a comedian, who is just not funny.
By the way, in breaking news, Ashley Judd just tweeted that buying Apple products, again, is akin to rape from her iPhone. Rape. Well, now she knows how my brain felt after Divine Secrets of the Ya-Ya Sisterhood. But we're bringing up... Oh, she said it. What is this obsession with Ashley Judd and rape? It's pretty unnerving. This next guy, there's so much...
Nobody even laughed at that. I guess he's not as cool as Sarah Palin.
Well, nobody is. You know, it's odd that he would say, what's their obsession with rape when all they do is obsess over rape?
Yeah.
I mean, think about how many news stories have come out about the GOP, about conservatives and their attitudes about rape. My overall take, and you know, this has been probably said a million times, but it's just because that's the way it is. You've got Reince Priebus coming out and saying, oh, you know, the autopsy report, we're reforming. I heard Ney say, or somebody say, I think it was him that said, oh, they're morphing. No, they're not. They're not reforming. They're not
no,
morphing.
No, they're just changing the message. They need a new PR campaign. That's what their whole thing is about. It's not about changing the message, just the messaging. Which
exactly.
Is ridiculous. Right?
Go ahead. Well, when you have anti-abortion laws popping up all over the country, when you're restricting women's reproductive rights, right there, just that alone, which is happening more and more, where Roe v. Wade is going down the drain state by state by state, they can message all they want. But if you want to get a message, that's a loud and clear message that their war on women is in full force.
Right? No, you're absolutely right. But they don't want to change the war on women. And
no.
In fact, that whole GOP autopsy, and don't blame me for the name, Reince Priebus came up with that, contains nothing about women. Nothing about women. They talk about outreach to... To Hispanics, to Asians and other minorities, even LGBT, but nothing about women.
Well, you know, it's interesting. I put up a post yesterday, and at the end I made up a graphic that says outreach my ass. And I went to Think Progress, and I grabbed immediately four headlines that showed what kind of outreach we're talking about here. Mm-hmm. Here's the four headlines. I'm not going to read you the explanation. How three top Republicans are already blowing up the RNC's minority outreach strategy. That's one headline. Next headline, Republican National Committee plan. More money in politics, more influence for rich people. Next one, House GOP budget would give millionaires a $200,000 tax cut. And the final one, it's the policy, stupid. Four policies that undermine the GOP's new voter outreach strategy. And they talk about, I do believe they talk about Latinos and the Hispanic vote and all that. So right then and there, I mean, you've got, in one day, you've got four headlines that completely obliterate their stupid autopsy.
Right. Right. No, again, it's not about the policy, which is what they need to fix.
Right.
It's all about, you know, how they're perceived. Well, they're perceived because of the way they are, because of what they do. You know,
they did mention women, in as I recall, at least Reince did when he spoke. He did say that they want to get more women out there in the media so that the women will be the ones delivering the war on women messages.
Okay. All right.
That's basically what they're saying. He literally said, we got to get more women in front of the camera in the media. So you've got, you know, and I noticed they started to do this on Meet the Press, and I've forgotten her name. I always forget her name, but she's a regular on the round table on Meet the Press now, who was at the time, I believe, speaking for Mitt Romney, dark hair. Anyway.
Oh, I know who you're talking about. Kathy McMorris Santos.
Yes, yes. Right. Thank you. That's her name. I always forget her name. But anyway, they started with her saying, yeah, let's get a woman out there because, you know, Mitt's not doing well with women. Well, look how well that worked out. So if they're going to now multiply the number of women faces on TV or women's voices on the radio,
right,
or women who write, if the women write and say and speak the same words that the men do, what difference does it make?
Because to them, it's all about appearances. They don't want, you know, they don't need better policies for African-Americans and Hispanics. They just need more faces to put out there. That's how they work. Herman Cain, you know, wasn't it Rush Limbaugh who said, you know, Herman Cain and Marco Rubio, and started rattling off the names of, you know, blacks and Hispanics who spoke at the RNC convention? He's like, why don't we get credit for that? Because of what they said, you fucking moron.
Yes, that's a, you know, and the other thing is, if you now step back and look at just the tone, and you touched on this, I think, just earlier, their tone is nasty and divisive and, you know, mean girlish and creepy and just hateful. And then it's sort of like the conventions, the Democratic convention was full of positive and let's do this, let's do something constructive to make things better for more people. And then you've got the GOP message, which is constantly negative, constantly, how can we shrink the outreach rather than expand
it? Right. Right. I'm sorry. Everything about the Republican Party is just, you know, I haven't pulled this out in a while, but.
Welcome to Opposite World, where in is out and up is down. Brought to you by Honorable Speaker of the House, Little Johnny Boner, and his really big gavel.
By the way, you know, in Bob Ney's book, there's a lot of good stuff on Boner, Little Johnny Boner. Also from Ohio, and they came up around the same time, and Boner was always a dick.
Oh, yeah. In fact, he responded by saying, oh, he just trying to sell book. You know, that's what his answer was. When that book came out, he knew he was in trouble. Right. Yes.
Yeah. I guess we should continue with the Republicans while we can. You know, when you say the Republicans have a messaging problem, it probably doesn't help to have your you know, the guy that you might want to be president in 2016 spell out exactly the faults of your party.
If Watson were to read the blogs, the tweets, the Facebook posts that mention the Republican Party, it would find that all too often we're associated with being anti-everything.
Yeah, right.
Way too many people believe Republicans are anti-immigrant,
yes,
anti-woman, anti-science,
yes,
anti-gay,
right,
anti-worker, and the list goes on and on and on.
Yeah, you are.
Many voters are simply unwilling to choose our candidates, even though they share our core beliefs, because those voters feel unloved, unwanted, and unwelcome in our party. So tonight, my thought is this. If Watson can learn from its past mistakes, so can we. This means that we must move beyond the divisive and extraneous issues that currently define the public debate. Never again can the Republican Party simply write off entire segments of our society because we assume our principles have limited appeal. They have broad appeal.
No, they don't.
No.
And actually, you know, maybe you should stop saying that, you know, your brother kept us safe. And my favorite quote of last week is,
I am proud to be a Bush.
Did you hear?
I'm, you know, he said they share our core beliefs, but they don't like our message. Well, those are their core beliefs. So, you know, I guess they don't like you.
Yeah.
He's
proud to be a Bush.
I missed that one. Did you just play a clip?
No, I just played again.
I am proud to be a Bush.
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
You know,
you keep saying that. Just keep saying that because that'll just doom you.
Well,
yeah,
I will. It's right here on my wall.
I am proud to be a Bush.
It's right there.
Yes, that's right. The Jim bumper sticker from Jazz Cat Trio in the chat. Proud to be a Bush. And then show him with his brother.
Yep.
You know, here we are on the 10th anniversary, right, of the Iraq war. That's so depressing.
I know.
And he's proud to be associated with the person who lied us into a fake, you know, fraudulent war with a country that never invaded us.
Yeah, but
proud
there,
to be
there's,
a Bush.
There's also this one, and I should put this one up.
I love my brother. He is a man of integrity, courage, and honor.
Really?
And during incredibly challenging times, he kept us safe.
No, he really didn't. Actually, we were the worst attack on American soil, I think, in history. I think 9/11 was worse than Pearl Harbor. Happened on his watch. He did not keep us safe.
No, of course he didn't. You know, I was listening as Addie Stan was talking about how the Republicans run far-right people to, you know, to get into office, that more and more of them are running, and you were talking about why is there so much attention, or why does it seem like there are more extremists out there? Is it the attention they're given? Is it that there really are more? Is it the party is really being pulled to the right? Is, you know, a number of questions that you guys were talking about. And I wrote in the chat room at that moment, why is it that on our side, we don't run more progressives? I mean, we're starting to a little bit, I guess. We've gotten some good progressives in. Mm-hmm. But our tendency isn't to, oh, yeah, let's get someone farther to the left. You know, let's run them and really pump them up. We usually find ourselves, like, who was it that the Obama administration? Oh, it was Ashley Judd.
Yeah.
That they're trying to not, to discourage.
They don't want to help her, right. Well,
yeah.
Because they don't like to support anyone going against Republican leadership. They wouldn't support Justin Kasule, who ran against Boehner. They won't support candidates against Cantor. Who was it? Drawing a blank on his name. I can see him. They won't support the guy who ran against Paul Ryan. The Democratic Party will not support anyone going up against Republican leadership, which is disgusting. That's why I don't support the Democratic Party.
Right, same here. They keep sending me things like, why aren't you renewing your membership, which I think I had years ago. You know, I don't think I've renewed it in a long, long time.
Mm-hmm.
Because of that reason, I mean, I think I did what you did, and I wrote back to them, and I said, you know what, when you stop doing this, and when you start doing this, you'll see my money pour in.
Right.
I
don't give any money to the DNC, DCCC, DSCC. I'll give it, if I have it, directly to the candidate or through Blue America. You know, Hallie Klein, Digby,
right.
John Amato's group, or the Progressive Change Campaign Committee, or somebody who's really doing, you know, working to get progressives elected. But as I said to Addie, you know, my fear is while the Republican Party moves further to the right or goes after, you know, this neo, as she called it, neo-libertarianism, the Rand Paul mm-hmm. nonsense, the Democratic Party is following them to the right and turning into, you know, the Republican Party of old.
That's why
you have people like Charlie Crist and Patrick Murphy who say, all right, I'm a Democrat now, because today's Democratic Party is like the Republicans used to be.
Right. And as Speaker, I think it was Speaker saying in the chat room, and I happen to agree, so we're now getting more relatively conservative people into our party.
Yeah.
Which, you know, I'm not
fun.
Like, I mean, that's great. Yeah, that's great.
And meanwhile, right. But in meanwhile, and Mike M asked us to talk about the CPC budget, which is called the back to work budget, I believe is the official name. And just so you know, I've been trying to get Congressman Raul Grijalva on the show this week as his, you know, they're on recess next week. Apparently this week his schedule just didn't work. But next week, all next week, Monday through Friday, I'm in for Randy Rhodes. And we should be able to work something out to get him on the show one of those days on Randy's show and to talk about it. But here's what I wanted to say. The media pretends like there were only two budgets released, the budget, the right wing budget, courtesy of Paul Ryan, and the official Democratic Party budget from Patty Murray in the Senate. But there was a third one, and it was put out by the Congressional Progressive Caucus, and Business Insider did a blind survey. And they pulled out, you know, bullet points from each of the three budgets and did a random survey on which one the people like the best. And the progressive budget came out way on top. People liked it because it put people directly back to work and actually cut the deficit faster. I mean, it just made sense, but the media acts like it doesn't exist.
You know, it's like when you examine the components of Obamacare or the components of God, I've forgotten now what the other, but when you look at things individually, generally the public will go along with that. It's when you label it, if you say progressive caucus, you know, or
right.
that, then suddenly you get the labels and people balk at the labels. The one person I did hear talk about this budget was Bill Maher.
Bill Maher did on Friday night. He brought it up and pointed out the fact I just did. By the way, one reason you should follow along like my Twitter feed during the show is there's often a whole other show going on. So after I played Jeb Bush saying,
I am proud to be a Bush.
Not a Joe on Twitter tweeted to me and said, I too am proud to be a Bush ... eater. So I tweeted back, touche, and others are commenting, just so you know. Someone else said sushi, someone else said by design, someone else, you know, it was like, there you go. Okay.
If I turned on Twitter during this show, I would be even more incoherent than usual. So no, I'm not going to
do
that.
No, I just multitask. I tweet, I do everything during the show. All right. Before we move on, a couple other things from CPAC before I drop the topic for another year. Okay, shall we? We've all heard about, you know, Sarah Palin and how she said, you know, Obama on background checks, we should start with yours. And was sucking on her big gulp and all the other offensive
obnoxious
things she said, right? Here's another clip. It's only 13 seconds, don't worry.
Mr. President, we admit it. You won. Accept it. Now step away from the teleprompter and do your job.
And the crowd goes wild. But the really funny thing is the picture that you posted right next to it, which is her teleprompter.
She's at the looking at a teleprompter. She's done this over and over again. I had, I think, three pictures up. And she's not alone. Marco Rubio has said the same thing. Rick Santorum actually said it should be illegal to read off a teleprompter.
As he was reading off a teleprompter?
I don't know if he was. I really don't know if he was, but most of the people who have said that are reading off teleprompters. And the thing is, teleprompters are really a good idea because you cannot possibly memorize a 45-minute or a 30-minute speech, and you get parsed with every single word. You know, every word is looked at, everything is examined and analyzed, and so you need notes, whether they're on your hand or whether they're on a piece of paper. Now, if you over-rely on them and you can't go off script, okay, granted. But I don't know any – I don't know too many other than – well, even Joe Biden, you know, he goes off script and he may say things that we laugh at or that are actually really cool, but at least he goes off script occasionally. Everyone needs some talent to be a politician, and talent means speaking off the cuff, being able to, you know, just get it out there, say what you want to say, but also it means sometimes you got to read a teleprompter because you have too much to say.
Well, of course,
you have to be accurate.
It's a speech, and everybody uses the teleprompters. Sarah, you use them too. Why is this an issue?
Thinking on your feet is one thing, but delivering a coherent, long-form message is quite another, as she knows, as anyone knows who's ever given a public speech. I don't know anyone who just gets up there and wings long public speeches unless it's a casual setting and you're not a politician.
Right. Right.
But if you're a politician, you will have your words played over and over, as we're doing right now, so you better get it right.
I hear you. I hear you. All right.
Not to mention it helps keep eye contact. I mean, you know, it looks like you're looking at it.
I know, right. Well, it's just, you know what? It's a tool that people use when giving a speech. There's nothing evil about it. It's both sides use it. Everybody who gives a speech uses a teleprompter.
Of course. It's
not a big deal.
All it is is automatic notes. Electric notes that run for you rather than you having to flip papers around and keep your nose down into your notes. It lets you look up and it scrolls. So what's the difference?
I don't know.
There is no difference.
There are, right. I know. She's just fucking nuts.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I love this. I didn't realize it, but Rachel Maddow on Friday night mentioned this little tidbit. That, for whatever reason, CPAC invited Mitt Romney to speak, but Fox didn't carry it. Now,
yes.
CNN and MSNBC did. However, as she put it, Fox was too busy interviewing Alan Colmes, and they certainly couldn't break away from that, to carry Mitt Romney's speech. Now, here's a little bit of Mitt Romney's speech. And listen, it's only 22 seconds. Don't worry. We're not going to. But here, listen to what he said.
I met heroes in the homes of the nation. Single moms who are working two jobs so their kids can have the same kind of kids other kids in school have. Dads who don't know what a weekend is because they've taken on so many jobs to make sure they can keep the house. We're a patriotic people. The heart of America is good.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So he said, you know, he met these great people, you know, these heroes who work three jobs, you know, because America is good. And you, we had the same thought. It reminded me of a clip from W that I've played numerous times on this show. It's the uniquely American clip.
There's a certain comfort to know that the promises made will be kept by the government. You don't have to worry.
That's good, because I work three jobs and I feel like I contribute.
You work three jobs?
Three jobs, yes.
Uniquely American, isn't it? I mean, that is fantastic that you're doing that. Get any sleep?
Get any sleep? I guess it is uniquely American to have to work three jobs to keep food on the table and a roof over your kids' heads. It's wrong. It's dead wrong, and it's nothing to, it's not an applause line.
No, it's not. It's, again, it's your opposite world. It's, as a quote from Arthur Delaney, this is how I first found out about that clip, Romney, the misery of working people makes America great. You know, so they're applauding the misery of the American people. We're scrounging and hoping and trying to get work and trying to keep our kids from, you know, starving to death, and that's an applause line.
Yeah, again, here's Mitt Romney just this weekend.
I met heroes in the homes of the nation. Single moms who are working two jobs so their kids can have the same kind of kids other kids in school
have. Kind of kids. And he read the teleprompter wrong. I don't even know what he was trying to say. Single mom who works two jobs so her kids can have the same kind of kids other kids have. What?
So their kids can have the same kind of kids other kids in school
what?
Have.
What
does
Dads that
even who mean? Don't know what a weekend is because they've taken on so many jobs to make sure they can keep the house.
Why is that a good thing?
You know, and the ironic part is, of course, that the GOP will block any jobs bill that comes their way and put up abortion bills.
Well, of course. And that's the thing about, again, the progressive caucus budget. It's the back to work budget because it actually puts people to work. And that's
why
you don't hear
about it. Well, that's just not American.
Yeah, I guess.
I mean, come on. Why would we want to help Americans if they already have two and three jobs that they're holding down and have to find child care for their kids?
Right. Now they're just being greedy. What, do they want a fourth job, damn it?
and then, of course, they come out against child care for their kids. I mean, that's the thing. They cut child care as they're saying, hold down those three jobs, women who we don't care about one iota, and we won't provide birth control to keep you from having more kids that you have to put on welfare.
Right. And of course, you know, Mike M. in the chat room just says one in five kids will go to bed without a meal today.
Right.
That's in America, the wealthiest planet, the wealthiest nation on the planet. And we have, you know, 20% of our children are food deprived. And, there's a new documentary out called A Place at the Table, and the fact that we have a hunger issue, that we have food insecurity in this country, is obscene. And Mitt Romney is one of the most obscene, and he's like talking about the heroes who are working three jobs and a father who doesn't know what a weekend is because he has to work all these jobs to keep a roof over their head. Disgusting.
That's family values. He cares about life. We're pro-life. We just want to watch the people who are alive just stay barely alive. That's
right.
The difference, see?
Right.
We actually believe, you and I, actually believe in people having a full life, a comfortable life where they don't starve to death. And the conservatives appear to want people to barely stay alive. Mm. And as they sit in their private jets and accompany their money offshore.
I know. It's sick. It really is sick. And then, you know, one last thing on CPAC. Here's what one of the people behind the Tea Party, whatever they are. Listen to the analogy she makes here.
Seven of the 10 wealthiest counties in America are right here in Boomtown, D.C. It's very much like Capital One. And I mean, the capital in District 1 in the Hunger Games. Care Act is a con. In reality, it's unaffordable, callous, and cruel.
Because it's going to give people access to health care who presently don't have it, right? What?
Our country's equivalent to the Hunger Games tributes will be the patients who die under this law.
So she's equating the Affordable Care Act with the Hunger Games. And what about all the people who die because they can't get health care, or because they, even worse, they have insurance, they pay through the nose for insurance, but the insurance company denies their benefits?
Right. But the insurance companies are raising their premiums as we speak.
But so she's equating the Affordable Care Act to the Hunger Games. And then they had a big, like a ball, a big, you know, party at night, a fancy party with a Hunger Games theme.
Oh, my God.
Now, for those who don't remember or didn't read the book or watch the movie, the Hunger Games is they fight to the death. These people are sick.
Yeah, no, they and I don't know if they realize. I mean, they have to. Are they that self-unaware or unself-aware? I don't know how to quite say that. Are they really that naive about what they're saying? It's mind-boggling. And you know, we do hear this kind of thing over and over again. So I have to think that they believe what they say and they know what they're saying.
Yeah, stupid is stupid does, isn't
Yeehaw.
That right? Yeah, that's Forrest Gump. I'm quoting Forrest Gump.
Mm-hmm. All right.
All right. Are we done with
yeehaw? I wasn't even quoting anybody. I was quoting George W. Bush. Yeah, we're so done with CPAC. We hate CPAC.
Okay, we're done with CPAC. So now it's time for
Guns in the News.
I haven't done it in a while, but boy, there's plenty of them. Let's start right here in Florida. This hit the papers yesterday. A student at the University of Central Florida was found dead in his dorm room. Tell about the story, and then I will give you the update from today's paper.
Oh, good, because I looked around yesterday, and I couldn't find anything as far as the update. Yeah, they found this kid. I'll read you from the university statement. The university police got a call, and they responded to a 911 call regarding a man with a gun. And when they arrived, they found a victim who died of an apparent self-inflicted gunshot wound. The dorm was evacuated. The garage was closed. And as investigators reviewed the scene, they found a handgun, an assault weapon, and IEDs.
Mm-hmm.
IEDs.
Yeah, right. Lovely, right? Well, here, let me update you on this. It's from today's South Florida Sun Sentinel. You ready?
Oh, good. Okay.
All right. A former UCF student still living on campus drafted plans to kill others in his dormitory, but changed his mind early Monday morning and took only his own life. So I guess we should thank him for this. James Oliver Sivakumaran, 30 years old, was found in his dorm room in Tower 1. By the way, a 30-year-old living in a dorm, you know there's a problem to start with. A seven-story structure near the UCF arena. He died from a single shot to the head fired by one of his newly purchased guns, police said. UCF Police Chief Richard Beery said writings found in his dorm room indicated, quote, there was a planned attack. When they searched his room, officers found an assault weapon, a handgun, hundreds of rounds of ammunition, and in a backpack, handmade explosives. The assault rifle had a magazine capable of holding 28 bullets. It could have been a very bad day for everyone here. Let's just face it, one shooting is bad enough. Multiples is unthinkable. Let's see. Police suspect this guy of Lake Mary pulled a fire alarm in Tower 1 shortly after midnight and planned to shoot or injure other students as they evacuated, Beery said. But they believed he changed his mind, returned to his room, and killed himself. That may have happened because he first pulled a gun on one of his roommates, who then escaped to a bathroom and called 911. The sound of police arriving may have prompted the shooter to alter his plans. A roommate, Beery said, described the shooter as someone who had, quote, antisocial tendencies, but not as someone he suspected of violence nor someone known to have weapons. Anyway.
Yeah, that's what I, at the end of my post, I was asking, you know, what kind of history does he have? Does he have any mental health issues that we would have known about or that anybody knew about? Does he have a history of violence? Why was he suicidal? I mean, you know, I was poking around looking for that, but I kept seeing the same AP report over and over and over again. So I'm glad you at least gave me some more insight here. But wow, roommates. I mean, can you imagine how the roommates feel?
Yeah. Can you? Hello. Well, when your roommate pulls a gun on you, yeah, get out of there and call 911.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Apparently today, and I don't know if I saved it. Oh, cool. Okay. Now, Michelle Schacht, by the way, an update, just tweeted back to me. Let's talk 8 a.m. Pacific time Thursday. Oh, boy. Okay, that's 11. I may have to move Bob Nay. But we'll do it. We'll do it. I'm going to have to move Bob Nay. Ay, ay, ay. Okay. I wish she would just call me so I could. Okay. All right. Let's see. Where else are we?
I'm surprised this story didn't get more. The one that you and I just talked about was the one that got all the attention on our blog. The one that I really think is amazing is the next one about Brandon Maxfield.
Okay.
The 26-year-old.
Uh-huh.
To me, this just is amazing. There is a story about a quadriplegic, right? He's 26 now. When he was 7 years old, he was shot. A 20-year-old family friend was watching him and a 12-year-old relative. And the 12-year-old found a family gun that was left unlocked in a drawer, an unlocked drawer. Mm-hmm. And the 20-year-old tried to unload the gun. The gun went off. It hit Brandon. And it wounded him so badly that he was not expected to live. But he did live. But he's a quadriplegic. He can't move, or he can barely move his arm. He doesn't walk. This is from the LA Times. He requires a ventilator to breathe through the night. He takes a pharmacy worth of medication, including antidepressants, for the terrible nightmares he has about his parents dying. His mother, of course, feels horribly guilty. So this was a Saturday Night Special that was in that drawer. And so he now has helped to take down the gun maker of these Saturday Night Specials. And the mother's quote, that the one that hit me, was I trusted that gun for our safety. It ruined our life. This should be the motto. This should be on a banner somewhere. I trusted that gun for our safety.
Right. Okay.
All right.
Yeah. Well, and there you go. And as we've talked about so often here,
there
are no shooting accidents. It's all negligence, and they trusted that gun for their safety. Shocker. It wound up making her son a quadriplegic.
Well, not only that, but the gun maker, the guy, his last name is Jennings, apparently he covered up a jamming problem with that type of gun that they were making, the one that shot Brandon. Quote, when the safety was on and the slide was pulled back to check for a bullet, the gun would jam. And then there's another quote, that's like removing your seatbelt just before a crash. And rather than spend a nickel, it says here, per gun to fix the flaw, the gun maker rewrote the gun's instructions telling the users to remove the safety before pulling back the slide. Now, here's the happy ending, right? So the gun maker goes out of business. Brandon got millions of dollars, which helps his medical expenses. The company closed down. Jennings moves away to another state. But it says, meanwhile, Jennings did not live happily ever after in the Sunshine State. He lost his federal firearms license after breaking his wife's jaw. In January, he pleaded guilty in federal court to possessing and distributing child pornography and is facing up to 30 years in prison. So there you go. There's your good guy selling guns to other good guys. Only the good guy selling the guns was a really, really bad guy.
Right. Yeah. Again, guns, not great. I love this other story, and I've got one more that I don't think you have yet. Drunken cheating husband fights with wife, shoots his own finger trying to remove wedding band.
Yeah, this guy had cheated on his wife, and so they got into a fight about his cheating, which had happened some time ago. And he got really drunk, and he wanted to remove his wedding ring during that fight that they were having. So he takes his gun, and he tries to shoot the ring off. Instead of shooting the ring off, the ring stayed where it was, but his finger, of course, got completely mangled. So here he is, the good guy with the gun again. Could have killed someone, and he ends up shooting his own finger.
Unreal. Unreal. All right, here's the other one. This just broke last night. We finally have a little more information into about what the guy, the Newtown shooter, was thinking, I guess.
Oh.
Yeah. The gunman in the shooting rampage at Sandy Hook Elementary School was obsessed with past mass killings and even created a detailed spreadsheet more than 7 feet long, documenting hundreds of killing sprees and attempted murders. This is reported by the New York Daily News. Mike Lupica, you know what? Let me see if I can't find the Mike Lupica piece, because I'd rather read that one. Hold on. Mike Lupica, which is the original reporting on this. Here it is. All right. This is what he wrote. Give me a second as it loads. Sorry about this. All right. It is 3 months since the killings at Newtown, since 20 children, 6 adults were gunned down at Sandy Hook Elementary School less than 2 weeks before Christmas. It has been reported previously that law enforcement found research about previous mass murders at the home. It was more than that and worse than that. What investigators found was a chilling spreadsheet, 7 feet long and 4 feet wide, that required a special printer. A document that contained Lanza's obsessive, extensive research in 9-point font, that's little, about mass murders of the past and even attempted murders. But it wasn't just a spreadsheet, it was a score sheet. We were told he had around 500 people on this sheet, a law enforcement veteran told me Saturday night. Names and the number of people killed and the weapons that were used, even the precise make and model of the weapons. It had to have taken years. It sounded like a doctoral thesis. That was the quality of the research. The law enforcement vet attended the International Association of Police Chiefs and Colonels mid-year meeting in New Orleans last week, a conference where state police colonels share information with each other and learn from each other. One of the speakers this year was Danny Stebbins, a colonel from the Connecticut State Police. He spoke for a long time about the morning of December 14th at Sandy Hook Elementary. Those in the room were told of the first responders in Newtown who have since quit their jobs. So shattered were they by what they found when they got to the school that morning, when they saw dead teachers with their arms wrapped around the children they had tried in vain to save. The man to whom I spoke, a tough career cop who did not wish to see his name in the newspaper, was in the room when the state cop from Connecticut spoke. Said the man was well into his presentation when he began to talk of the spreadsheets that had been found at the shooter's home. He didn't use Lance's name, saying he would not want to give him even an hour more of fame, just because that is what he wanted, what all these shooters want, from Tucson to Newtown to Virginia Tech. We keep calling them murderers, the veteran cop to whom I spoke said, but there should be a new way of referring to them, glory killers. They don't believe this was just a spreadsheet. They believe it was a score sheet, he continued. This was the work of a video gamer, and that it was his intent to put his own name at the very top of that list. They believe that he picked an elementary school because he felt it was a point of least resistance where he could rack up the greatest number of kills.
Oh, my God.
That's what the Connecticut police believe. The man paused and said, they believe that Lanza believed it was an easy way to pick up the easiest points. It's why he didn't want to be killed by law enforcement in the code of a gamer, even a deranged gamer like this little bastard. If somebody kills you, they get your points. They believe that's why he killed himself. They have pictures from 2 years before with the guy all strapped with weapons, posing with a pistol to his head. That's the thing you have to understand. He had laid this out years before. He didn't snap that day. He wasn't one of those guys who was mad as hell and wasn't going to take it anymore. He had been planning this thing forever. In the end, it was just a perfect storm. These guns, one of them an AR-15, in the hands of a violent, insane gamer. It was like porn to a rapist. They feed on it until they go out and say, enough of the video screen. Now I'm actually going to be a hunter. Those who didn't know about, that's the end quote. Those who didn't know about his life on his way to the gates of hell were told in New Orleans about the plastic that covered his own windows in Newtown, Connecticut, the town he would make famous as a way of making himself the newest glory killer famous. We were told about how in the last days of his life, not a single ray of light could get into his room. He was finished with his spreadsheet by then, the old score sheet, one that did not yet have his name on it. The whole thing was chilling and riveting, the law enforcement official said. Sorry, I'm going to run a little late here because I'm going to keep reading this. The fascination Lanza had with the subject matter, the complete and total concentration, there really was no other subject matter inside his head, just this. Kill, kill, kill. It was really like he was lost in one of his own sick games. That's what we heard. That he learned something from his game that you learn in police school about how if you're moving from room to room the way he was in that school, You have to reload before you get to the next room. Maybe he has a 30-round magazine clip and he's only used half of it, but he's willing to dump 15 rounds and have a new clip in it before he moves into the next room, end quote. The career law enforcement veteran paused again, and when he started speaking again, his voice was shaking like a wind had blown through it. Quote, they believed he learned his principles of this, the tactical reload, from his game. Reload before you're completely out. Keep going. When the strap broke on his first weapon, the AR-15, he went to his handgun at the end. Classic police training, or something you learn playing kill games, end quote. The police in Connecticut believe that Lanza's mother, a gun lover, was an enabler of her son's increasing obsession with guns, that she was making straw purchases of guns for him all along and ignoring the fact that he was getting more and more fixated on them. At this point, I asked the man what we can possibly learn from what happened with Adam Lanza and his mother and what finally happened at Sandy Hook Elementary on that Friday morning in December. He said, quote, the amazing thing is, as much of a tragedy as it was, it really could have been much worse. We heard that in New Orleans, those teachers, the whole school, they did everything they could. There's nothing more they could have done. Despite the great loss of lives, they did save lives by acting the way they did, end quote. He said when the presentation was over that day, he walked out of the hotel and into the New Orleans morning, 3 months removed from the Sandy Hook Elementary, but unable now to shake what he called the visual of Adam Lanza's spreadsheets, the seemingly endless list of names and numbers compiled for God knows how long, the list on which he wanted his name at the top, because all of the easy kills he thought he could get at an elementary school. Then I called my wife, he said, and told her about it and started to cry about Newtown all over again.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That's so sick, I can't even fathom how sick it is.
It is really sick. This is from the New York Daily News. Mike Lupica, who, by the way, used to be a sports columnist, I'll post the link to this article. So do with it as you will, but at least now we sort of know what was in his sick, demented mind that day.
And his mother was certainly an aider and a better.
Yeah, that's what it sounds.
These people who enable other people knowingly, it's mind-boggling to me.
Yep, I hear you. Got a laugh? Find her at thepoliticalcarnival.net. Sorry to end on such a downer of a note, but I thought it was important to get this in here. By the way, I will finalize all the details for Thursday morning. As it now looks, Michelle Schacht will join me on the show Thursday morning, 11 a.m. Eastern. I'll cancel the news. I'll try to move Bob Ney into the first hour of the show, and we'll just have to move Juliana Forlano to next week again. All right, so all the full details tomorrow morning. All right, got a laugh, thepoliticalcarnival.net. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll send this one out to Michelle just because it's my friend Jill Sobule. Come on, let's play it. Where is it? Why is it not playing? Why is this not working? Let's try it again. Ah! And it doesn't want to play. Oh, there's something wrong with my thing here. I don't know why. Why won't this play? All right. Never mind. We'll just go out with this. My music player is not working. All right. So on that note, we'll go out with Stevie Ray Vaughan. All right. Thanks, Laffy. And I'll talk to you tomorrow. Thanks for hanging. It's radio or not. Bye, everyone.